this new wave of business models we've seen is really still very young, and nobody has really figured out the playbook. Banking days. Got out of school in the early 90s and did the whole investment banking shtick for a while in New York at Goldman Sachs, and came out here for the first kind of dot-com gold rush in 97, and had a couple of throws in that, a couple of which were successful, a couple of which were not, and then went to work for a larger company during the turbulent times, you know, during the recession post 9/11 when things kind of went into shutdown mode, and I worked at BEA Systems. Which is a middleware company. We were then acquired by Oracle for about $8.5 billion, and then I went to Oracle, stayed there for less than a year as part of the executive transition team, and knew very well I wanted to go back to the startup world. And long story short, the venture firm that led the Series B in Aria introduced me to the company and said, hey, we'd love you to take a look at joining the executive team here. And they're reaching that point now where they need some, you know, adult supervision and people that have been there and done that as far as building out and scaling businesses. So that was 6 years ago, unbelievably. And I joined when the company was about 25 people, and now we're approaching 300 and about 25x the size in terms of revenue and amount of transactions, amount of customers, all the key metrics we look at for the size of the business. Entirely venture-backed and exclusively focused on the enterprise market and then the upper mid-market of high-growth, younger, bleeding-edge companies that are not classic enterprise in terms of Fortune 500, but nonetheless are well on their way to being such. Companies like Roku, Hootsuite, that have young, innovative, very disruptive technologies, and they are taking those to market and in very quick hyper-growth mode. So it's very exciting.
What is it that you love about working with startups?
I think startups bring a tremendous amount of intensity in terms of the opportunity before you, the pressure on a competitive window that's open for you to be very aggressive and taking advantage of in terms of changes in the marketplace. And I think people are either very attracted to that and they embrace it, or they curl up in a fetal position and that's too much stress and anxiety for them. I very much enjoy that stress and that intensity of we need to move very quickly, we need to move with a tremendous amount of forethought in terms of not only the next move on the chessboard, but two or three or four moves down the road on the chessboard in a market that's evolving very quickly. That to me is very exciting. And the unpredictability of it in terms of where we are today, both as a company and in the markets and the customers we serve, and where we will be a year from now or 2 years from now. We are in an unprecedented amount of change in the world in terms of technology driving a whole new emerging set of business models and consumer behaviors. And I think where we're gonna be a year or two from now is gonna be something that probably nobody's even thought about today.
You were here during that dot-com boom in the 90s. How does that sophistication around sort of strategic company growth compare now to, I guess it was 15, 20 years ago now?
Yeah, it's night and day, and I think that's where I think the press inaccurately draws a lot of parallels now to all this bubble talk and drawing parallels to what was going on in 98 through 2000. There were a lot of innovative, interesting ideas in that period, and companies that received a lot of money that probably shouldn't have, companies that went public that probably shouldn't have, because it was all on the premise of an idea and a concept. I think the same holds true today, but today the successful companies you're seeing that are getting funded, that are going public, that are getting customers, these are real businesses. they have the numbers to back it up. It's not just a slick PowerPoint slide that says, close your eyes and imagine the following and just think of what we could build. They're building it. And the revenue is there, the customers are there, the transactions are there, the competitive cannibalization is there in terms of market share that they're eating up from the incumbents. These are all very real business models, and I think the investment community and certainly the customers that those markets are serving realize that, and they vote with their wallets. Well, I think we had a very fortuitous set of events with our technology. So when Aria was initially started, and even upon my joining, you know, cloud and SaaS and these types of next generation architectures were still not fashionable. It was still considered kind of bleeding edge and fraught with a lot of risk. And, you know, is that really going to happen, or is it just kind of a passing fad that's going to fade away in a year or two? The jury has obviously spoken, and not only are they here to stay, but they are growing much faster than anybody had anticipated in terms of enabling technologies for businesses and consumers. So that hyper growth that we've experienced in cloud-based services has been a phenomenal uplift for us in terms of our service, because we are 100% cloud-based. And the second, you know, line that intersects this growth trend is the growth in recurring revenue models. So whether it's subscriptions or usage models or on-demand models, it's this whole new paradigm of the way that consumers and businesses want to buy services. They don't want a fixed flat rate transactional pay and go away type economic model or relationship model anymore. They want it to be a recurring relationship, a recurring service, and they want the transaction itself to be the start of the relationship, not the end of the relationship. So that has really turned a lot of these business models on their ear. And in so doing, companies have come to us saying, hey, we, in order to serve this market and address this market and be as agile as we possibly can, we need next generation technology to enable these models and to maximize our customer experiences, and enter Aria. Perfect timing for that mega trend as well.
With so many fast-growing companies, specifically in, I guess, Silicon Valley, how do you think that's impacting things like brand, the way that we present ourselves to market, and also the way that we present ourselves internally from a cultural and team leadership point of view?
Yeah, it's really interesting. I think before, you know, all the science that went into brand was about the product. What do you think of when you think of the product? I think now the product is the relationship. Sure. What do I think of when I think of that relationship and that service I'm getting from a certain provider, whether it's cloud services that a business is consuming or whether it's consumer services like an Uber or a Netflix? What is that service to me? And I associate the removal of friction and what's the delight factor in that service with the brand. And that all-encompassing experience that I have with consuming that service, that to me becomes what comprises the brand in and of itself. And what do I think of when I think of, okay, I'm gonna get Uber? What's that gonna be like as far as an experience?
How do you manage that whole concept of brand or that relationship, that perception at that CEO level? What does that look like?
Well, so for Aria in particular, when we talk about, you know, our product and our service and what we really try to foster in terms of our brand, the nature of what we're selling and to whom we're selling it, we really have a blueprint of a minimum of a 10-year relationship.
Sure.
And so the way we've constructed our entire go-to-market model, from pre-sale solution design all the way through implementation, through customer support and account management, it's with that ongoing partnership model in mind.
Sure.
So when you look at any of these customer models that are consumer focused, they are really honing in on what's going to drive retention and upsell and cross-sell. If they can really nail those things in terms of what is the right mix of products, services, pricing, bundles, and general subscription management features that they want that end customer to experience, that is going to drive retention, upsell, and cross-sell, they feel like their business is going to be much more valuable when it gets valued by Wall Street and the analysts or the venture community. Because if you go and you have a successful consumer offering, but yet, oh wow, there's 80% churn in the first 90 days, that's not going to excite anybody.
How do you compare New York to San Francisco culturally in the business community?
It's interesting. There's been quite a bit of convergence over the last 10 to 15 years. If you look at historically, you know, New York in certainly the 90s through the early 2000s versus San Francisco, it was absolutely clear that, you know, San Francisco was the epicenter of technology and innovation and startup funding. And if you look at any, you know, mathematical analysis as far as venture flows and where the money is going and where the public companies are coming from, it was largely Bay Area. Now you're seeing much better distribution of that. I think New York has realized certainly what an engine of the economy these startups can become. They've become a more startup-friendly environment for fostering up startups in Silicon Alley and then throughout the different boroughs of New York. And that kind of California air of informality has taken hold out there. To put a finer point on it, you know, in the 90s, if you show up at a meeting in New York in anything less than a suit and tie, they'd think you're there to, like, take out the trash or something, you know. Now, you know, this would be considered formal.
Sure.
Certainly is for San Francisco. So that cultural air of innovation, and just because you're young doesn't mean you don't have great ideas and some business acumen, I think has really converted a lot of the New York more conservative throes of what can happen.
That consumers are changing and that it's not just technology that's innovating, but certainly the way that consumers interact. What's your thoughts on that?
Well, it's interesting, and you know, you could say it's these demographic shifts of like the millennial mentality or this entire generation growing up taking technology for granted, whether it's mobility or a smartphone and having a supercomputer in your pocket and the immediate channels of communication that one always has. But I think that whole mentality has also shifted the balance of power between the companies that are serving these markets. And the consumer is now going to dictate the terms by which they want to buy a service. And if the company cannot accommodate that, then they're out. The consumer is going to go to somebody else. And I think you're seeing that in spades with how services are delivered today. So the consumer has become really the driver of the economic models that these companies are offering. It used to be entirely in the company's hands, like, okay, you want razors? This is how you're going to buy them. You're going to go to your drugstore, you're going to buy them, and you're going to go home and come back when you want to buy more. And now you're seeing subscription services for razor blades, for toothpaste, for the hotel industry, for the automotive, you know, the cab industry. You know, there's all these obvious examples with OTT plays. That's because the consumers have said, look, this is the way I want to do it. And whoever can accommodate this is going to make a ton of money, and I'll be happy to pay them. And then in so doing, Wall Street's going to reward those companies, meaning, wow, you've got a thriving recurring revenue business now, Mr. Netflix, and they're going to get a premium valuation on their company and the franchise they built around it. So, you know, not to sound too harsh, but it's as if the consumer has become kind of a petulant child in terms of, this is the way I want to buy it, and if you can't service my needs in the way I want to buy it, when I want to buy it, how I want to buy it, then I'm going to go to somebody else. But the companies that are addressing that need, they're making a killing. And the consumer's also very happy with that, too.
What do you think that does for companies who are either starting up or even looking to accelerate or transition in the way that they approach their strategies? Because certainly 20 years ago, it's very different to the way it is now. Customer-centric isn't the right word. It almost doesn't give it enough attention. Yeah.
Well, I think there's two things. I think the authenticity piece, it could not be more important for us as a company in terms of our brand and what we're extending to our customers when they know they're entering into a relationship with Aria. They've got to know that what we are saying and the expectations we're setting are the right ones and are proper, and we're not just trying to BS our way through a sales cycle to win them as a customer. So that authenticity in terms of us being able to look them in the eye and say, look, this is what we can do, this is what we can't do, but this is what we're going to do together as this relationship grows, and we're going to be completely honest with you around what some of the ups and downs are going to be, and we expect the same in return for you. That, to me, is becoming the new working model between technology companies and enterprise companies. And you're seeing a lot of the companies are really repelled by the traditional large technology companies and the way they've historically handled their customers in terms of more of an an extortion or racketeering. Like, look, this is the way it's going to be. If you don't like it, then call your lawyers. That whole relationship experience and the partnership dynamic is pervasive throughout if you want to be successful. So that air of authenticity could not be more important in driving that.
What do you think those keys to helping companies at various stages grow and accelerate fairly quickly?
Well, I mean, you need to continually look in the mirror and violently iterate your own model and not be dogmatic about this is the way we're going to do it and this is the way it's going to be done, unless you're willing to change very quickly, whether it's in terms of product, roadmap, in terms of the way you sell solutions, the way you implement solutions, is what drives the growth. And you've seen many examples of companies that have refused to iterate or innovate for fear of cannibalizing their existing business. And those companies are now dying on the vine, and they're getting completely outflanked by the young, disruptive companies that are very willing to iterate very quickly and break glass, and there are no sacred cows.
What are some examples of that kind of scenario?
Siebel saw that. They had an on-prem system. They were the absolute world's leader in CRM, and Salesforce came along and completely ate their lunch. That's a case study that will go down in history, because Mark Benioff and the Salesforce team listened to the customers and said this is how they want to consume the service. They don't want on-prem software. They want a much more agile methodology of receiving software and the software updates. They did that, and they completely leapfrogged, you know, Siebel in the process. You're seeing many, many examples of that with content providers that are not willing to disrupt their distribution channels, and they want to insist that they still have exclusive deals with the pipe providers that have access to the set top, and they have been really resistant to going straight into the mobile device. And those that have resisted that change have gotten badly bruised for doing it. There's no, you know, sacred cow in terms of the distribution model. We've got to give consumers what they want, because if we don't, that consumer is going to go somewhere else. The whole notion of going home to your television because you want to watch an episode of Friends or Seinfeld, or having to make a phone call from a landline, is completely, you know, prehistoric at this point.
One of the conversations I'm having around this concept of not necessarily just having a mission statement and not necessarily just having a vision statement, but actually how do we live out of those values in the way we portray ourselves externally, internally, in the way we innovate?
Yeah, I mean, it's really interesting. You know, you bring up a good point. Most companies feel like they need to have a mission statement and here are our core values, and they pin it up on the wall or make cue cards out of it. But do they really follow through on that in terms of the actions they're taking inside or outside of the company? I would posit that that's the exception, you know, not the rule, when there's really the actions are consistent with the values that the marketing department or the HR department has put up in the kitchen and, you know, things like that. Unfortunately, actions speak louder than words, and we can sit up there all day long and preach to our employees, our customers, our prospects, our partners, but actually doing it and showing real life examples of it and that getting around, and you start to establish the street credibility of, wow, these guys really are high integrity players, is enormously important. So that brand of integrity and honesty, if we lose that, then it's all for naught. We are in the midst of hypergrowth right now. I think you're going to see tremendous change. We very much want to continue to be a standalone company and build a $1 billion business, and I'm sure that's exactly what we're going to do. This is not a little niche play where you come in for a quick hit. This is a fundamental shift in the way that business is being done today, and these companies are in desperate need for next generation technology to make it a reality, and so we've timed that beautifully. And if you look at any of the venture history or startups and companies that have succeeded in technology, more than anything, it's about the timing. And were you at the right place at the right time in terms of your technology and what the market was wanting? And those stars have aligned very nicely for us. So we intend to go full throttle on scaling that out now. A lot of these companies, you know, are doing one of two things. They're either launching new initiatives, and they don't have the foggiest idea of what's going to be effective. in terms of pricing, packaging, bundling, and all the different rules that surround driving that end user experience. Or they're overhauling existing initiatives, and they're saying, look, we need to make this more, you know, experience driven. We need to drive a higher proclivity for these customers to renew and to upsell and to cross-sell them. What's going to work? This new wave of business models we've seen is really still very young, and nobody has really figured out the playbook for, okay, you're going to go B2C in the streaming market, this is what you need to offer. I mean, look at all the competitive angst out there right now between, you know, Pandora, Spotify, and every other, you know, audio streaming service in terms of what is the right economic model. What is that secret to success? And how can I experiment to find out what is the right combination of things? There's been a dramatic shift in the last 3 to 4 years. Wow. With Fortune 500 companies and their willingness to A, buy cloud-based services, and B, buy them from young startup companies. I think they realize, you know, back to my earlier point, they're not getting what they want from their incumbent providers. So they say, you know what, you're not going to provide me the solution I need, the agility I need, the care and feeding I need as your customer, then I'm out. You look at all these identity crises and debates that are ensuing inside the hallways of, you know, IBM, Oracle, SAP, yeah. They know it's happening. And that's also why they're buying companies. We're definitely seeing a shift back to best of breed for CRM, for marketing automation, for monetization, for GL, for tax. I want what solution is going to work the best across all of these. And I think the combination of wanting what is going to be the best fit for your business combined with some innovation we've seen on the connective tissue that allows these technologies to integrate to one another has really made the whole sales pitch for a single stack from one provider kind of moot. And they'd much rather have the best technology versus just a one-stop shop. And again, I think a lot of it is because the line of business is driving the urgency and the imperative. And they want certain features and functions and abilities that will allow them to do more creative things on their go-to-market. And they don't want to be told by IT, well, sorry, we only buy everything from Oracle and Oracle can't support that. The line of business says, I don't care that I'm not signing up for these growth rates. And you need to get something in here that will enable me to do what I want to do with my business in order to hit my targets. And that's why you're seeing these best-of-breed practices get slotted in with, you know, regardless of what the functionality is.
You say best-of-breed. What do you mean by that?
A single technology that is proven to be the best at doing what it does versus sure. Just, hey, Oracle or SAP or IBM offer the same thing, and you may get it from the same store, but it's probably, you know, third or fourth place in terms of its ability, in terms of features and functions and, you know, ability to handle different use cases. I'll take this, even though it's third rate, because it's really important I buy everything from the same vendor. I think those days are over. They absolutely want best of breed across the different stacks that they run.
So a startup asks to have coffee with you. They say, we've got this great idea. What kind of advice do you give them?
Hire well.
Sure.
You know, it sounds like motherhood and apple pie, but you really need to make sure the people that you have on your team and representing your company are very consistent with the fabric of the culture that you want to be able to showcase. I would tell the person that's just getting going, you know, who's your team? You know, who do you want on your team? Because that's the team that's going to go out and talk to investors. That's the team that's going to talk to customers. That's the team that's going to go out and recruit people. That's going to be the brand that the company is creating in terms of, hey, do I want to work there? Do I want to be at this company? Do I want to do business with this company? Do I want to invest in this company?